lunch, prepared MOU, and then send it to them.
So we'll begin with the third session of this day, second day of the FDP. Attendees are requested to open your OR software for hands-on. Okay, sir. You can start, sir. Over to you.
Can you see the slides too? Can you see the slides?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Visible.
Right. So now we try to understand one more TikTok topic, which is about the. As I said in the beginning, that is the first hand tool towards analytics that you would try to look for the central tendency of the data. You want to know where the data is mostly concentrated and how much is the variation and what is the structure of the data in terms of a lack of symmetry. For example, when you have extreme observation, then this is skewness, kurtosis, etc. Also, they help you a lot in identifying such observations, right? So let us try to begin one by one. And so when we are talking of the central tendency of the data, you see our objective is very simple. We just want to see where the most of the data is concentrated. Well, if you have this type of data which is concentrated somewhere like this, so also I want to know this point here, that what is this point around which most of the values are concentrated. So for that we have the so-called measures of central tendency. Now there are different measures of central tendency, and it is the job of the statistician to actually find out that which of the tool is going to help here in retrieving the correct information. That can be arithmetic mean, that can be median, that can be mode, that can be geometric mean, harmonic mean, etc., etc. Once we have this type of data, for example, if I have here two types of this set data, and suppose here there is another set data set indicated by this cross, right? So you can see here what is the difference between the cross data and these dots, that that this cross data and this dotted data, they both are concentrated nearly at the same place, like this one here. But the spread around this variability, spread around this central value of this individual value, is more in the cross data. So that is why we need to understand the concept of variance or standard deviation, or standard error, etc. And sometimes people do get confused that mean and standard deviation, they are interrelated, or by knowing the value of mean, they can conclude about the variance or vice versa. So I would like to clarify here that arithmetic mean is for measuring the central tendency of the data, and variance, standard deviation, etc., they are for measuring the variation in the data. When we are trying to measure the concentration of the data, that can be around any point. For example, if I have this data set contained in this circle, so I can find out the concentration around this value, concentration around center, etc., etc. So that is the general concept, but usually in practice, we are more interested in the concentration around the arithmetic mean. That is why we have this concept of variance, that is, that measures the variability around the arithmetic mean, right? And then I will try to take up the issues of this skewness and kurtosis. And definitely by looking at the value of mean, you cannot judge anything about the variability or vice versa. That is, after looking into the values of variance, you cannot judge what is the tendency of the mean. Higher variance, lower variance, that does not indicate anything about the mean values. That should be clear in your mind. But yes, these things are interrelated because variance is going to be measured around the arithmetic mean. So in that sense, they are interrelated. So means I believe that you all have used this arithmetic mean many, many times. So my objective here is mainly to explain you how you can compute these things in the R software. And in R software, if my data here is something like X1, X2, Xn, that is, these are some numerical values, 10, 20, 30, 40, etc., which are combined in a data vector here, X. The arithmetic mean is actually computed by this statistical formula, which is sum of all the observation divided by the total number of observation. And directly, this can be computed by this command mean, M-E-A-N, mean. And inside the parenthesis, you have to give the data vector. Now you see, this is exactly what I was telling you in the beginning yesterday in the introductory part, that this R has both the capabilities. Means now if you want to write the program for this function, well, if you know the basic fundamental of the programming in the beginning when we are children, then we are taught it is something like sum is equal to sum plus num, etc, etc, those type of thing, and then we can write down the program for the summation also. So using that formula also, we can also write down the function, write down the program for the mean. But somebody already has written that program and this has called as mean. So now you can see here, mean is nothing but this is simply a function. Now even if you want, you can also write down the function. So mean is the function, and inside the parenthesis you are trying to give the input data, and then it will automatically compute the mean value. So don't you think that it is equivalent to what you do in the software where you just click and get the mean? The only thing is this here, instead of clicking, you have to write down the mean, M-E-A-N, and even if you go to the RStudio, then as soon as you type here ME, I think AN will come automatically. So I don't think it's a bad option. And then you have a complete control over here, that if you want to find out the mean square, you can always write the data vector X and then mean, and you can square it. These things are not possible. For example, if I say in any window based software, if you want to compute the square of the mean somehow, how can you do it? That is not possible. There will be only that you enter the data, the click here, and then you will get here the value of mean. That's all. So this was the most powerful part, or the biggest advantage of the R software, that you can use this built-in commands. It is just like clicking on the mean option, but you can also square it. You can do many, many things which you cannot do in any window-based software in general. There's some software maybe there where you can do, I don't know about them, but in general, these things are not there. Right, so now similarly, if you want to compute the geometric mean, at least I will tell you that what is the formula. Now actually there is no built-in command for the geometric mean, and but this is given as, this is the sign of the product. So that means all the observation x1 x2 xn, they are going to be multiplied, and then their nth root, that is raised to the power of 1 upon n, is formed. Now if I ask you how to compute this thing, there is no command like GM or geometric mean. But don't you think that you can just write by your basic knowledge of R software? What is this inside this parenthesis? This is simply the product of X1, X2, Xn. So if you simply write down here PRODX, you are done. Then you have to write down here 1 upon N. N is here the number of observations. So you can simply write down here hat 1 upon length of X, that's all. So that is the advantage here. Even if the function is not there, you can write it down very easily. Yes, I'm pretty sure that I haven't seen any window based software where you can compute the geometric mean and harmonic mean also. But in many situations, when you are trying to do computation like computation of the interest rates, etc., then there you need these types of thing. And similarly, if you try to see here, harmonic mean is defined here as say n upon summation 1 upon xi. So if you try to see here, this is, don't you think that it is something like 1 upon this summation x means 1 upon xi and then divided by here n. So don't you think that this quantity is something like mean of 1 upon x? Now this is the advantage. Means if you simply write here 1 upon x, x is that data vector, then every value will become 1 upon xi. So now I can simply write down here the command to compute the harmonic mean directly here, like this 1 upon mean of 1 upon x. So you can see here that it is not very difficult to compute these things. Similarly, if you want to compute the median we had discussed in the last lecture, that this is actually the second quartile. This is the value which is trying to divide the entire frequency into two equal parts, that 50% value will be below median and 50% value will be more than median. Right, so if you want to compute this in median, then you have to simply use the command here, median, and then inside here x. So median is the middlemost value, which is trying to partition the total frequency into two equal parts. So now there can be a small comparison that under what type of condition you are going to use more mean, median and mode. So if you try to see here that as I took the example in the morning itself, that if there are some extreme observation, very high value in the arithmetic mean, then arithmetic mean will be drastically changed. You can see here that 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus upon say here 3, that will be 2. But if I try to make it here 1 plus 2 plus 3 upon 100, so this will be divided by 2 and this will be much, much greater than, means this value will become much more than 2. So this extreme value is going to change it a lot. But in case if you try to see here the median is 1, 2, 3, the median is the middlemost value 2. But if you try to 3 here, 1, 2, 3 here, 100, still the median is going to be the 2 plus 3 divided by 2, which is here 2.5. So even with the change in the actually this 2 to 2.5, that is not because of 100. Even if there is a value here 5, this will become 2.5. So median is not at all affected by the extreme values. Now, similarly, if you try to look into these values, geometric mean and harmonic mean, if you have any value xi which is 0, then what will happen? As soon as you multiply here some value by here 0, the entire product will become 0. Right. So that means geometric mean cannot be, that's not a good way to estimate the central tendency of the data. And similarly, if you try to see here in the harmonic mean here, 1 upon xi, 1 upon 0, that will become infinity and then everything will be blown up. So, and then there are places, because once you are trying to use the geometric mean, then the lower value gets higher weightage and the harmonic mean higher value gets lower weightage. So it depends. There are situations where people do advise that under this type of conditions you have to use either mean, median, geometric mean or harmonic mean. Right. And particularly when we are talking in the context of data science, where the data is coming automatically, you have no control. So you have to think, this is actually only you. Means God will not come to us to tell us, okay, Kalab, here you use mean, here you use median. Okay, God can give us the signal, but God will not come on the Zoom or Microsoft Team to tell us that, okay, you better you use median in this case. You are the one who is going to take a call. So you have to take a call based on the nature of the data and the condition under which the data is being collected. Means if you try to see if there is a website which is selling this clothing for the youngsters, right? Means I'm sure that many times youngsters are wearing different types of dresses which look good, but if I try to wear it, I will look like a cartoon possibly. But do you think that when you are trying to gather the data on the that what are the customers who are going to visit that website, most of them are going to be youngsters only. Unless until a father wants to buy a shirt for his son or daughter, usually that number will be very, very low. So in that case, we can expect that the data is going to be homogeneous in the sense that the variability is not going to be very, very high. There cannot be, or there may be very less extreme values. So possibly we can safely use their arithmetic mean. But in case if you go to a website like Amazon, where a 3-year kid is also going to Amazon, and a 70 years old person is also visiting the Amazon. For example, my nephew, he's around 10, 12 years old, but for the last 4 or 5 years, he will simply go to my Amazon account. He will simply put something over there and he will simply call me and said, okay, means I have put something in your cart and you please buy it. So these types of things may happen. And so in that case, the variability is going to be very high. There can be extreme values. People are of a 70 years as well as 4 years, 5 years. So in that case, median sounds to be a better measure of central tendency if you are trying to measure the central tendency of the age. Similarly, if you try to go for the income part, this income part, if you try to see, if you go to Amazon, there are things which are with whose cost is starting from 5 rupees to a couple of lakhs rupees. But if you go to another site where they are selling the clothing for the youngsters, that may not be very high. So in that case, there cannot be extreme observation, or the variability among the observation is very less. So depending on that, you can choose whether you want to employ mean or median. The reason why I took this example, that it's not only the statistics which is only help. Statistics always goes along with your common sense, your experience. And I always say that a good applied statistician has to be a very good social scientist also. He has to observe what is really happening in the society. But anyway, these things come by practice and by experience. But definitely, if you want to find out here the arithmetic mean, geometric mean, harmonic mean, well, I can take the same example. I have especially taken the same example so that you can understand. And now you will see that if I give you here this outcome, you will say that it's not really needed to go to the R software and you want to do it. But still, I would ask you to get it done. You already have MPC data in your file, so you just take this data and try to find out here mean of MPCE and just check whether you get the same value or not. Well, I'm sure that you will get it. So that is indicating the value of arithmetic mean. Similarly, if you want to find out here the geometric mean, you can use the same formula that we did earlier. You have to simply, instead of here X, you have to use here MPCE. That's all. Right, and then MPCE, and then you can very easily just compute the geometric mean here. Similarly, you can compute here the harmonic mean by this formula, and you can see here the median also. This is coming out to be same. Now I can show you that how are you going to take the different types of conclusion from the same result. Here you have to simply observe. The arithmetic mean here is 1383 and median here is 1245. So if I try to plot here a frequency curve means you try to plot all the values on a graph, and if this value is coming out to be symmetric, then in this case actually mean is equal to median. So if the value of mean and median, they are very, very close to each other, just by looking at these two values, you can believe that the data is nearly symmetric. And if you try to look at my hands, this is my curve, and if there are some more values on here left hand side, that means I'm trying to pull this curve on the left hand side or on the right hand side, then what will become? This curve will become something like this, or something like this. So that means the mean is going to be changed, but the median will remain the same. So depending by looking at the mean and median, you can very easily compute whether the distribution is skewed or symmetric. So Chris will try to discuss when we come to other aspects. Now here, there is a contradictory thing which I mean, not contradictory, but I will say that the troublesome thing which I explained you yesterday, and I will try to show you here, that in case if you try to find out here the mean of 1, 2, 3, 4, this will come out to be only here 1. But if you want to take the mean of C1, 2, 3, 4, this will come out to be here 2.5. So this is exactly what I was trying to tell you yesterday, that whether to use the C command or not when you are trying to do such calculation. Now you can think about this situation that you have written a 200-500 lines program, and in somewhere the data is coming, and then simply you are trying to compute the mean, and then that value is transmitted further. Now if you have not used the C, R cannot raise the hand and can say, okay, you have made a mistake. But what will happen, there is no C here, so it will give you the value 1, and then this value will be transmitted further, and all the calculation will be made only with the value 1. There will not be any warning, any error, no NA, no null. But the correct value is actually here 2.5. So that is what I meant when I said yesterday that you always try to use either C. Yes, some commands may work well, some commands may not work well. So either you try to just check before the execution what is happening, or you simply uniformly use the C command. Right. Similarly, when you want to measure the variability, so as I said, the variability can be measured at any point, but that makes more sense when it is measured around the arithmetic mean. And there is a statistical law also that the variability is measured by this quantity. And if you try to see what are we going to do, we are trying to take individual observation, and we are trying to take its deviation from the arithmetic mean x bar. Now this value can be negative, this value can be positive. So instead of taking its positive negative sign, we will try to square it so that it becomes independent of the sign. Yes, you can take absolute value also. And then now this is the individual measurement. So now, but we want a single combined measure based on all the values. So I will try. So best option is to take the arithmetic mean of this squared deviation. And once you try to do it here, this will be the be a single numerical value which will give you an idea of the variability. So how does it say work? Suppose if I take here a data set here like this, in which the values are very close to the arithmetic mean, and another data set is here like this, in which the values are quite away from the arithmetic mean, and if I say that v1 and v2 are the variances of 1 and 2 data set, so this v1 is going to be much smaller than v2. So now what will happen, that if you got a two data set, and if you want to study about their variability, what you have to do, simply try to find out their variances and then try to compare them. In case if the variances are pretty close, that means both the data sets have similar variability. But if the variation is very high, then you can say that, okay, the first data set or the second data set, whosoever variance is low, that has got a lower variability. Right. Now, in case if I ask you a simple question that you want to compare the heights of the students, and if I say, okay, in my class, the variance is 9 square, and in your class, the variance is 36 square. You will get an idea that, okay, there is a huge difference, 9 and 36. But if I try to take its square root, because that is height square, that is something like meter square. But if I try to take its positive square root, then the units will be the same as if of the arithmetic mean, because arithmetic mean will be measured in only meters. So Now, if you try to take the positive square root of 9 and 16, that will become here only, 9 and 36, that will become only here 3 and 6. So now you can see psychological thing. Comparing 3 and 6 and comparing, say, 9 and 36, don't you think that this gives you a very different type of feeling? Yes, 9 and 36 looks too huge, but 3 and 6 does not look that huge. So that is why when people started using the concept of variance, they thought, okay, instead of taking the square, if I try to take the square root of this variance, so anyway, that is the arithmetic mean of the squared quantities, so that has always to be positive. So they started considering the square root of the variance of x. So this is called as a standard deviation, and more specifically, that is also called as a standard error. The difference between a standard error and a standard deviation is that a standard error depends only on the sample values. So here you can see this is a function of only x1, and this x bar is also a function of sample values x1, x2, xn. So these things, so in a nutshell, I can say that, okay, if the quantity can be computed on the basis of given set of data, then means if the variance can be computed on the basis of given set of data, then its positive square root will be called as standard error. And suppose it depends on some unknown parameter. Suppose if I take here, okay, x bar is some unknown parameter here, mu, we don't know the value of mu, then that will be called as a standard deviation. So that is the basic difference. So now if you try to see here that if you want to compute this here variance, then the command here is var. And if you try to take a standard deviation or standard error, you simply have to use the square root function, which we did yesterday, and you try to take the square root of variance of x. Right, but now I want to give you here one thing actually here more. Right, that when you are trying to compute the variance in theory, in concept, then from the statistics point of view, there are two forms of the variance. Well, there is a very valid reason. So, but then I will try to show you here that here I have used here the divisor here, let's say n. And now I'm using here the same quantity in the numerator, but in the denominator, this is n minus 1. So when you are trying to compute the variance in our software by the command var, which is here, then actually this gives you this particular value. The variance which is measured with respect to the divisor n minus 1. This is not n. And there is a reason for that one. Because you can assume that your data is coming from a population which has got some population variance that is unknown. In the statistics, we have a subject where we teach how to estimate these unknown parameters. So when we try to use a very good method for estimating these parameters, which is called as maximum likelihood estimators, then or the principle of least square, then they tell us that if you try to estimate the population variability by this expression with divisor 1 upon n minus 1, then this is going to be an unbiased estimator of the population variance. Well, what is unbiasedness, consistency, that I'm not going to talk here, but that is one of the property for estimator to be called as a good estimator. So that is why, because this variance is going to be used in different instances, so as a statistician, we always prefer to use this form of variance rather than 1 upon n. But in practice, and particularly in the data science, if you try to see, this will not make any difference. Because once you have a data which is, say, this thousands and millions and billions, whether you are divided by one less observation or not, that is not really going to impact much. But surely when you are trying to do in the finite sample, then you have to be careful if you have observation like 20, 30. then you need to be careful that you use the appropriate term. And if you want to have this type of mis-expression here, 1 upon n upon n, 1 upon n minus 1, means if you want to compute this type of variance with the divisor 1 upon n, it is very easy here. You just try to multiply and divide it by n, and then just try to write down here n upon n. And then this quantity is going to be computed by here variance. So actually you have to take here n minus 1 and n minus 1, right? So, and then if you try to just see here, this can be computed by this quantity without any problem. So, but that will not make any difference if you are trying to do with the data science. That will not make any difference. And actually, these two estimators with the divisor 1 upon n and 1 upon n minus 1, they are obtained by two different methods actually. But we will not go into those details now. Means another measure of variability is range. Range means maximum minus minimum. Whatever is the maximum value and whatever is the minimum value of the data set, try to find and then take their difference. So this is called the range. So here I would like to have your attention that in R, if you want to compute this range, then you have to use the simple command max minus min. If you try to use here this here range command, this will also work in R, but this range will give you here an outcome like minimum value and here maximum value. I will try to show it on the R console. So this is not range. Actually, ideally, I should call it this maximum minus minimum as a statistical range. So the statistical range, there is no direct command, but you can use the maximum minus minimum command and you can compute it. And similarly, there is another measure here that people try to measure the variability in terms of the quartiles. So third quartile minus first quartile, this value is called as interquartile range, and in R you can simply compute it by IQRX. Remember one thing, this is here capital I, capital Q and capital R. So this is the case sensitive, so you have to use here capital IQR here, right? And sometimes people try to use the half of the distance between third and first quartile. So that is actually called as quartile deviation. So if you want to find out the quartile deviation, that is actually pretty simple here. You just try to find out the interquartile range and divide it by here two. And the fact is this, means I can always ask you to write a one line program where without using this direct command, you can also write the syntax or the function for computing this quartile deviation. You know how to compute the third quartile. You know how to compute the first quartile using your quartile function, which using p equal to 0.3 and p equal to p equal to 0.75 and p equal to 0.25. Just write those, find those quartiles, and then you can write down these things. So this is how people have written the functions whose name is IQR. Right, okay, so when we are trying to measure the variability, I assure you that we are essentially trying to observe the difference between the individual observations and the arithmetic mean, say X bar. So now obviously this difference can be positive or this difference can be negative. So if you try to sum them it, then it may be possible that their sum is close to zero, indicating that there is no variability, but the variability may be there. So we would like to get rid of the kind of this difference. So one option is this, that you try to take positive sign by taking its square or by considering its absolute value. So when we squared it, we had the concept of variance, but now we are going to take its means absolute value. Right, so now and then we will try to find out this absolute deviations for each of the observation, and then we will try to find out its arithmetic mean, and this quantity is called as mean deviation. Right, and now there is no direct command here in this R for computing this mean deviation, but now you can see here it is not difficult at all to write a direct command for this thing. Well, I am writing, if you try to see here, what is here this quantity? This is simply written by here absolute of here x minus mean of x. That's all. And now either you take it as I have done here, sum of this thing divided by the length of x, or if you simply try to take it here mean of this thing, this will also work. So once you know the basic fundamentals of the very elementary functions for the programming, getting these values is not difficult at all. And definitely this mean deviation is least when you try to measure this deviation around the median. That you can prove mathematically, but in practice, we are trying to measure the, we are actually more interested in the arithmetic mean, so we are more interested in getting the variability around the arithmetic mean. So that is the reason that mean deviation is more popular when it is measured around the arithmetic mean. But surely if you try to, for the same data set, you try to choose your arithmetic mean or the median, you will see when it is median, the value will come out to be smaller. So whenever you are trying to take the skewed data where you expect that there are outliers, try to use here the median instead of mean. Okay, so now let me try to show you here that how these things are going to work. So for example, you can see here I try to take here the same data set mean, and I try to use here the variance. We are on MPCE, just take it the square root, you will get here the standard deviation. If you just take it here AQR of MPCE, you will get here this interquartile range. If you divide it by 2, you will get here the quartile deviation. And if you want to find out here this mean deviation, you simply have to just replace x by MPCE, and then you will get here this value. So you can see here that this mean deviation is coming out to be 398, and whereas the standard deviation is coming out to be 530. Because you can see here that here the variation is too much actually, 648, 3000. So you can consider that there is an outlier that may be, well, that depends on you how you want to interpret it. But I think first let me try to, before I come to R console, you can see here the same thing will happen in the variance also. If you try to compute the variance without the C command here, it will give you error. So you have to use it here only with the C command, right? Okay, so anyway, so let me try to complete this thing. Okay, anyway, let me try to first show you that these things, how they are possible in our console also. They are the very, very simple thing, not difficult, but anyway. So let me try to copy, and if you wish, you can also just do the same exercise side by side what I am doing here. So you can see here, now I can control L, clear the screen. Then MPCE, this data is already there because we used in the earlier lecture. So if I try to find out here mean of MPCE here, MPCE. You can see here, this is here like this. And if you want to find out here the geometric mean, it is here like this. And simply here one upon mean of MPCE. So this will give you here. So this will give you here the harmonic mean. Similarly, if you want to find out here the variance of MPCE, you can see it is very simple. Just use the command VAR. And if you want to find out its square root, I mean the standard error, so you have to simply take it here, the SQRT of this variance of MPCE. This will come out to be here 530. And similarly, if you want to find out the interquartile range of MPCE, you can see here, this can be obtained here like this. And if you want to have the quartile deviation, that will be IQR MPCE divided by 2, right, and so on. And if you want to find out the absolute mean deviation, I can simply write here mean of absolute of, say here, MPCE minus mean of MPCE. Right, sorry, here I have made a mistake here, because this absolute value is for this entire thing. Right, so you can see here that if you make a small mistake, the R will not tell you that you have made the mistake, but it will simply tell you some value which is wrong. So you have to be careful. Right, okay. So now I come back to my slides once again. Right, so now you see these are the individual thing, and you can see whether this is minimum value, maximum value, mean, median, etc., etc. They try to reveal different hidden properties of the data set. Right, so now when you have more than two data sets, suppose we have two data sets, one is here, second is here, and I want to compare them. So don't you think that the comparison will become easier if I can write down a function which gives us all the summary measures at the same time? So that is why in R there is a function here, summary, SUMMARY, and if you try to use it on the data vector here X, then it will give us the value on the minimum, maximum, first, second and third quartiles. So this helps us in comparing the two data sets side by side. For example, if I try to take here this here MPCE here, and then I try to find out here summary MPC, it will give us the outcome like this thing. You can try it yourself on your laptop, that it is giving us the here the minimum value, here the first quartile, here the median second quartile, then the arithmetic mean third quartile, maximum value. So suppose if you have got two data set, if you try to find out their summary, possibly means they can be put side by side on it, and in fact there will be, if you try to find out the summary of more than two values together, it will just make you side by side, and then you can compare it very easily. Right, so in order to compare this summary measure, actually there is a graphical procedure also. The graphical procedure is that you can create here a box plot, and this box plots also reveals many hidden information. These are very simple graphics, but believe me, they are very useful, particularly when you are trying to work in a bigger data set. So this box plot looks like this. This will be this type of picture. And where you will see here in the bottom, this will indicate the minimum value, and in the top there will be a line which will be indicating a maximum value, and then there will be here a box where you will have the value first quartile, then in the middle second quartile, and in the third middle quartile. So instead of having a summary command for this comparing the two data set, well, that also you can do. This box plot helps us a lot, and the command to create this box plot is very simple. Box plot, and then here just write down the name of the variable. So for example, if you try to create the box plot of this MPCE data, this will here look like here this. We can see here, this is here somewhere the minimum value, and this is here the somewhere the maximum value, then is the first quartile, median, third quartile, and so on. So now if you try to see, this is the minimum and maximum value, so this value is going to indicate about the statistical range of MPC, maximum minus minimum. And similarly, if you try to take this difference here, that is your here interquartile range, Q3 minus Q1. And by looking at this distance, you can see here that this distance is more than this distance. So that gives you an idea about the symmetricity, that there are more number of observation between the middle part and upper part, that means the second quartile and the third quartile, and there are less number of observation between the median and here the first quartile. So this type of different information you can get without looking into the data, and that is one of the biggest objective in the data science, where you cannot observe the data with your naked eyes. Right. Okay. So now, we have a provision here. For example, if you have two data sets or more than two data sets, we can also create the box plot in the same graphic, like as one box plot here, one box plot here, one box plot here. So they will be side by side, and then you can very easily compare them, that what are the hidden properties with this data set without any problem. Right, so why not to first create this box plot and try to see here what happens here. Right. So now you know how to create more than two graphics on the same graphic. So what I will try to do here, I will try to show you here that here is your here MPCE data. Right. And I try to create here box plot here MPC. You can see here it is looking like this. Right. Now what I try to do here, that I try to replace here the first value of this MPCE. See here one, it is here actually 900. You can see here this is 900, but I change it to suppose 9000, like this, very huge value. Right. And now I will try to plot here the box plot, because now you can see here that this value in the MPCE data, one value is now very extreme. Right. You can see earlier it was 900, now it is means 900,000. Right, so now you can see here that as soon as I try to recreate this box plot here, how it is changing. And then you can see here, okay, I forget to tell you, if you try to see here in this, there is a here dot. So that is indicating that, okay, there is some value which is very much different. That was actually your header 3000. So that is indicating that there can be an outlier or an extreme observation. But now I'm making it here more clear. So now you have to observe what really happens in the MPCE. You can see this has shrunk because there is a huge difference between this extreme value and this value. So what has happened if I try to make this value a little bit, say this higher, and then I try to make it here box plot, you can see that this is increasing. So this is here your value. It is indicating that there are two values in the data set which are very different from the remaining values. So now it is our job that we try to go to this place, and then we try to see whether these values are changing or not. So let me try to, and then if your original was like this. So you can see now here, by using different types of graphics, different types of pictures, you can very easily find out that how the things are working in this case. Right, okay. So now let me come back to my slides and let's try to now understand about some more properties of this thing. And similarly means if you want to have the summary command also, that can also be used. Actually, summary command and box plot, they are the same thing. Box plot is the graphical view of the summary command in some way. Right, okay. So now I come to the aspect of skewness and kurtosis. You see, whenever we are trying to deal with the data, the structure of data can be like it is symmetric around the central value, or it is more concentrated either on the left hand side or on the right hand side. So when this happens, then we have the property of skewness. And once we are trying to measure the hump of the curve, then it is related to the property of kurtosis. Right. So if you try to look here, if you try to see, this is here on the x-axis, this is the, sorry, on the y-axis, this is the frequency. So if you try to plot the frequency, you can see here you are getting here a curve in which this is symmetric around its mid-value actually, sorry. Yeah. This is here the mid value, right? And see here the values on the left hand side of this mid value, they are scattered in a same way, right? And their pattern is the same. So it is the symmetric. Symmetric means, have you ever seen the bell in the temples? So this is a shape like this. So this is the symmetric around the central value. So when the data is symmetric around the central value, then we say that we have no skewness. And when the data is more concentrated on the left hand side, you can see here is the maximum, here means here, then we here there is more concentration of the data than compared to this thing, then it is called as positively skewed. And if the opposite happened, that the data is more concentrated on the right hand side, this is called as negatively skewed. Now if these types of situations, if you try to see, if you try to take an example of the people coming to the shopping mall, and if you try to count the total number of people entering after every half an hour, so the shopping malls open at 9 a.m. and the shopping malls close it at 11 p.m. Right, so somewhere it will be here time between 6 to 8 p.m. There you will see there is a peak. So people, it means usually 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock people, means very few people will go to the shopping mall with multiplex where they can have some movies. Otherwise, usually people prefer to go to shopping mall in the evening or in the afternoon, late afternoon. So this pattern, if you try to see the number of people visiting the shopping mall, this will be negatively skewed. And similarly, if you try to see the number of children passing through a place which is very, very close to a school, means in the morning there will be lots of children which are coming there, say here between say 7 a.m. till here 10 a.m. and then after that up to say this 2 p.m. no children come, but after that they have their vacation, their school ends. So this type of thing, means if you try to see, the data is highly skewed in the sense that more number of observations are concentrated on left side, and sometimes more number of observations are concentrated on the right hand side. So this is essentially the property of the skewness. And our objective is that we want to measure it in a quantitative way. And similarly, we have another property here, kurtosis. Kurtosis means the hump of the curve. It's, if I try to make this picture on a single, you have a curve here. This is here the height of the hump. So there can be a curve who has got a higher hump than this, or you can have one hump lower than this. So this one in the center, this is called as mesocortic. And if this curve has more peakedness, then it is called as platycortic. If this is less, then it is leptocortic. Yeah, if I remember correctly. Yeah, right. So the question comes over here, that how does this, how do we decide that what will be the mesocortex curves hum? So in statistics, we have a very popular distribution, normal. Normal distribution is actually symmetric, and normal distribution is like here this, that if you try to plot the value of the characteristic with respect to x-axis, this would be here like this. I can give you a very simple example to understand how the normal curve will look like. You see, at our home, whenever our mother or wife cooks a curry, so the taste of the curry depends on the quantity of salt. So suppose if I try to plot this curve, on the x-axis we have the quantity of salt, on the y-axis we have that taste. So what will happen here, that when the quantity of salt is zero, then the taste is zero. Gradually, when the quantity of the salt increases, then the taste will improve. It will go like this. There will be an optimum quantity of the salt where the taste will become the maximum. And if you try to increase the quantity of the salt beyond this, then the taste will decrease. And finally, it will become very bad. So if you try to see, as we try to increase the quantity of the salt, the taste of the curry, it increases and then it decreases. So we are assuming that this is a symmetry behavior. All right, so then So this normal distribution has very nice statistical properties. That is one of the most behaved child of the statistics. So whenever we have the normal thing, we become very happy. And most of the statistical tool also depend on the normal distribution. For example, tomorrow we are going to talk about the test of hypothesis. One of the basic fundamental is that you assume that all the observations are coming from the normal distribution only. As soon as you deviate, the problems will start increasing. That is the same question we assume in our class, that all the students are coming to class very regularly. They are attending it. They are doing their homework, and then definitely they will get good grades. But suppose if some student comes and says, okay, sir, if I don't come to your class once a week, what will happen to my grade? Or if I don't submit your assignment, what will happen to my grade? I cannot say anything that what your grade will become, but definitely I can say with guarantee that your grade will be affected and it will become bad.
So there is one question.
Hello, yes,
from
please.
He says, good afternoon, sir. What is the role of increase in sample size on skewness? How does it influence normality?
Okay, yeah, wonderful question. Wonderful question. You see, means if I am a bad student and if I decide that whatsoever you do, I will not study at home. What will happen even if you give me 100 hours coaching, 200 hours coaching, or 1000 hours coaching? Will I be changed? No. But in case if I am a good student, but because of any reason I could not score well in your exam, then in case if you give me some extra help, like extra coaching, tuition, etc., etc., and if you try to increase it, my grades will improve. So exactly the same thing happens in this case also. In case if your parent population, if the parent population from where the data is being generated, if that is skewed, then whatever be the sample size, this skewness will always be there. But in case if your parent population is suppose symmetric, and due to any sampling error or any error, you have got the sample which is indicating the skewness, in that case, if you try to increase the sample size, this skewness will gradually disappear. Right? Shall I continue? Right, okay, I can continue. I believe.
Please continue, sir.
Yeah. So what we try to do, that we try to find out the curtices of the normal distribution, and whatsoever it comes, that is considered as a standard, and that curve is called as the mesocurtic curve. So any curve whose curtices is exactly the same as the curtices of the normal distribution, that is called as mesocurtic, and any distribution which has got more curtices than the normal distribution, that will be called as platycurtic, and whose curtices is less, that will be called as leptocurtic. Means I believe I have written the name correctly. I don't know. Yeah, I believe so. Right, anyway, so the one thing is this, means if I try to take here two curves here like this. Both are skewed, but now how to measure the degree of skewness here. So the degree of skewness and is measured by this coefficient. This is called as coefficient of skewness. And if you try to see here that it is it is simply your here one upon means the arithmetic mean of the cuboid deviations And here, this is actually the variance, and its power is 3/2. So this is a measure. You don't have to worry how it is, how it has been obtained. That is our job. We are getting the salary for doing these things. So this is how you can measure the degree of coefficient of the degree of skewness by this coefficient of skewness. We are more interested in how to interpret it. And similarly, the coefficient of kurtosis, which is measuring this here hum, right? That can be measured by this coefficient, which is here gamma 2 coefficient, which is 1 upon n summation xi minus x bar is power of here 4. And then here, this is here the variance, and this is here the variance square. So this value lies between minus 3 and plus 3 actually. So now if you try to see in this curve, you try to compute the coefficient of skewness gamma 1 and coefficient of kurtosis gamma 2, and simply try to look at their values. If gamma 1 comes out to be greater than 0, that means the curve is positively skewed. If this is exactly 0, that means it is 100% symmetric, but close to 0 is also can be taken as symmetric, because 100% symmetric is very difficult to achieve in practice in real life. And when it is negative, that means that it is a negatively skewed curve, and more data is concentrated on the right hand side. And similarly for the kurtosis, if you try to compute the gamma 2 coefficient, if that comes out to be exactly equal to 3, then it is platykurtic. The fact is this, under the normal distribution, when we try to compute this gamma 2 coefficient of kurtosis, this comes out to be 3. And if this value is less than 3, then it is platykurtic. Greater than 3, it is leptokurtic. So this is how we try to measure. So now our job is very simple here, that we have to compute these things in the R package. So these things are not available in the base package. So for that, you have to simply install a package here, Moments, M-O-M-E-N-T-S. Actually, what you have seen here, this thing, if you try to see, these are simply like here, summation I goes from 1 to n xi minus x bar is power of here r. So this is called here rth central moment. So right, so if you try to see here, this is in the numerator is the fourth rth moment, and in the denominator this is the square of the second central moment. So that is why this moments have their own roles. So these moments can be computed under the package here, moment. So this is the same thing. Now you can see this is the first encounter we are making. Now we have a base package in which there is no capability to compute the moment. So what has been done? Package has been created. It is uploaded on the website of the R. So you simply have to bring this package on your computer by installing it, and then use the command here, library command, so that the package is now activated to work. And then you have to use here the skewness, skewness, and inside the parenthesis you have to write the data vector. Well, there is no space here, right? Because I have just written it to make it more clear. Then kurtosis, k-u-r-t-o-s-i-s, and then it will give you here this value here, right? And yeah, further, and it is pretty simple actually. If you try to see here this MPC, this data, if you simply execute here skewness MPC, kurtosis MPC, you can get these values. And based on that, now you can decide whether what is the nature of your data. Right, okay. So now, Miss, do you have anything to ask? Miss, otherwise these are pretty simple thing. If you can just copy and paste in your R console after installing the package moments, possibly this will work. If you want to ask anything, I can first answer, and then I will try to move forward. And now you can see that these are very simple thing. Means you simply have to just write skewness and then get a vector. Once you do it, you will get it. Right, so if there are no questions, I will continue with some more topics. So you see, whatever we have done up to now, they are based only on a single variable. But in practice, we are trying to handle many situations where more than two variables are going to affect the process. For example, if I take a very simple example of from agricultural, the yield depends. Does it depend only on the fertilizer quantity, or it depends on fertilizer quantity of seeds, temperature, rainfall, moisture, etc., etc.? So there are actually most of the processes are affected by more than two variables, more than one variable. So our objective is this. That means when they are getting affected, there is some sort of relationship among them. So we want to study that relationship. The question is now how to get it done. So as we have done in the case of unidimensional case, there can be some graphical procedures, there can be some analytical procedure. So similar is the case when we are trying to do with two, three, or say higher dimension. So two dimension, three dimension, and after that we have multivariate analysis, which handles more than one variable at the same time. And then we have some analytical measures like covariance, correlation, etc. So we will try to talk about now these things over here. So
Sir, I think the mic was muted, unmuted only now. There was a question from your previous slides when you were asking. Can I ask question
Sir,
can you please repeat again why the gamma 2 was ranging from -3 to +3 only?
Yes, actually the thing is this, gamma 2 is based on the means the value of gamma 2 as a 3, right? This is the value of the coefficient of kurtosis in the normal distribution.
So it will always be ranging in -3 and 3. It cannot go beyond that.
No. And in statistics, actually, using our mathematical tools, we do prove that what are the limits of this these measures.
So when you are suggested to upload this package of moments, in that it will ensure that these limits are all taken care. We don't have to worry about it.
Yes. But there are two more variants of this gamma 2, which are called the beta coefficients. So the equation is that now in case I use the beta coefficient here, then it is very simple. Simply have to do the beta 2 greater than 0, less than 0, or equal to 0. So actually in this R software, when we are trying to for this kurtosis, this is trying to give us here the beta 2 coefficient, and in Tunis here this is trying to give you here the gamma 1 coefficient. Yes, sorry, I forgot to tell you about this.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thanks you. You asked and it came to my mind. Can think that after speaking for 5 hours, 6 hours, the brain gets low.
Sir.
Yes.
I would like to re-see your PPT number 61, page number 61, related to skewness and kurtosis. Yes, sir. You said that the range will be gamma 2 will be ranging from -3 to 3.
Here I made a mistake here. Sorry. Just delete this part. Sorry. Acha. I thought that she was asking for this thing. Yeah, so this will be gamma 2 will be equal to 3, less than 3 and greater than 3. Yeah,
okay.
That's sorry for this thing.
So this one is okay.
No, this one is okay. Gamma 2 actually, you see, it is this is lying means you have to simply compare it with the gamma 2 equal to 3. If gamma 2 equal to 3, then it's symmetry greater than 3 and less than 3. That's all. Because you see, this value can be between 0 and infinity, actually. This is not minus 3 to 3, but it is
okay.
0 to infinity. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Yeah, that was the confusion.
Sorry for the typo.
Yeah,
oh, no, sorry for the typographical mistake. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
And that is the reason actually that they try to define the beta coefficient just by taking here gamma 2 minus 3. So this gamma 2, so that instead of comparing it with 3, this is a human tendency to compare it with 0. So if it is 0, that means it is there is no kurtosis, and if it is greater than 0 or less than 0, you can go for platycotic and leptocotic. It's just like as a coefficient of skewness. So that is the point where you have to be careful in the R software, that skewness gives gamma 1, but the kurtosis give beta 2. Thank you very much for this, for correcting me. Right, okay, so now first we try to...
Yes, 1 minute, just repeat the statement, last statement. Gamma 1 gives the kurtosis skewness and gamma 2...
I can write down here.
No, no, it's okay, sir. The page where you have written beta 2.
And I can write down here also, beta 2 is equal to gamma 2 minus 3.
Okay, it's okay.
And so actually here
software
one, there is another here measure, which is square root of this here gamma 1. So I can actually explain you, it will just take 1 minute. I mean, if you're interested in statistics, actually when this gamma 1 will give only as the value, but if you try to see here that if this actually this is the sum of cube deviation, so that can be positive, that can be negative. So in case if this cube deviation is a negative, this gamma 1 will become here negative. So in that case, means we try to measure the sign whether this is positively skewed or negatively skewed. So this is the quantity in the denominator which is responsible for indicating the sign of the skewness. And this quantity, this will not make any difference because this is a squared quantity, so this will always be positive. So sometime we also try to measure this gamma 1 in the same units here, like as just by taking it here as a square root of gamma 1, and beta 2 we try to measure it by here gamma 2 minus 3. Actually there are many measures which have been defined to measure the skewness and kurtosis, right? So I just took the one which is being used in your R software actually.
Sir, when gamma 1 is negative, then square root will be imaginary.
No. Yes. So in fact, that's what I said. That is the symbolic representation actually. That is only the symbolic representation only. That we try to take the magnitude of the gamma 1 and we try to use the symbol, whatever is the symbol of this thing.
Okay.
So that is the way it is written here.
Okay. It means the absolute of the gamma 1. Then it is square root, and yes, the symbol will be allotted from the symbol of the gamma 1.
Right.
Okay. Sign will be allotted according to the gamma.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
And in beta 2 actually, and then in this case, kurtosis beta 2 will be gamma 2 minus 3. So you simply have to see whether this is less than 0, greater than 0, or equal to 0.
Okay. That's all. Thank you very much for clearing the doubts.
You're welcome, Father. I'm grateful that you pointed out this thing so that I was safe from making a mistake. Otherwise, it means I cannot sleep in the night if it comes in my dream. Right, okay, so now you see, so I will try to take it. Actually, you see, there is a very long list of the graphics which are available in this R software actually. So, but I will try to take here some very simple plots which are happy here actually. One basic command here is plot command. So plot if x and y are two data vectors, you simply have to say plot x, y. For example, we have used in the last example. So this is here plot x, y, and then you can option here, you can give it here type. So type here is something like, if you give here type equal to P, this will be for points. If you give it here L, this will be for lines. If you give it here for B, if it will actually both means points and lines actually both. And if you try to make it here C, that will be means only the lines without the both. And if you see here O, that is overplotted, means points and lines, they are overplotted. S is stair type, H is histogram type, or say high density vertical line. So I will try to take here a very simple example and will show you here on the screen, and then I will come to our console. Now, in this plot command also, my humble request to all of you will be that you try to just look into the help menu and try to see the different options. Some popular symbols, some popular means options which can be used here are, say, main. If you simply write here main equal to something, this will be the overall title of the plot, sub A for the subtitle of the plot, X lab A, that means title on the X axis, Y lab A for the title on the Y axis, and aspect is for the aspect ratio, that is Y upon X. So let me try to take here a simple example and try to explain you how the things work, how do they look, and then I will come back to my slides. So if you try to see here, I have taken a very simple example. This is the day temperature and water consumption in a city on say 27 days. So these are the paired observation. Say on a day one, the temperature was 23 degrees and the water consumption was 33710 million liters. In the second day, the temperature was 25 and the water consumption was here like this. So these are the paired observation. And now let us try to plot them. So I try to, I have stored this data as a plot and here temp, and I try to plot it here. Whatever you want, whether you want plot water temp, temp water, that is your wish. Right, so if you try to see here, if I'm simply plotting here water temp, then it is giving me this type of thing. You can see here, this graphical is saying that, okay, there is a sort of increasing trend. As the temperature is increasing, the consumption in water is also decreasing. And if you try to change it to here, plot temp and water, they will be simply be changed like as here, like this. Right, you can see here. So the pattern is not really going to change. Now, in case if I try to use here some option, suppose I use here, option equal to here, see here L. So L is for here line. So you can see that all the observations over here, they are here joined here like this. Right. So this is here like this. Right. And if you want to hear lines and points here both, then you have to give here the option here B, and then you can hear these are your here points and these are joined, these are points and they are joined by this here line. So you can see here there is some gap also. So, but that's a pattern. And similarly, if you want to overplot, because in this case you can see here that there is some here break, but if you want to overplot it, then use the command here O, and you can see here that all the lines are crossing over these points. Right. And similarly, if you use here the option here H, then all these points, they will be like a histogram here, these vertical lines will come here. Right. And similarly, if you try to take here, say, stair steps, so all those points, they are joined by a stairs, means as a, we have stairs in our home, like going like this. Right. So now, depending on different types of needs, you can just use whatever you want. Now I just try to show you some of the options that I said that they can be used. So you can see here that there is no title here, etc., etc. But I want to add here something. So I try to use here plot temp water, and I use to here X lab A. That means X lab means I want to add here. I think you can make here a one correction here. This is actually X lab. I have written here X lab A possibly. Please correct it. Right. So if you try to write down here X lab is equal to daily water consumption, you can see here this is coming here. And if you try to write down here Y lab is equal to day temperature, this is now coming here. Whereas earlier means it was simply here temp and water. Right. Similarly, if you want to make here a title, you can write down here main inside the double quotes, daily water consumption versus day temperature, which is coming over here. Right. So, and then you can control different types of tick marks, whatever. If you want to overwrite on the points also, those things are also possible without any problem. Right. So first, I think, let me try to make here these graphs, and then I try to, so that you feel here. So I can simply copy this data, and let us try to come to our. Right, so this is here your data here, water, and this is your here temp. So you can see here that if you want to see here plot between water and here temp, you can see here this is here like this. Right, and if you want, to have here plot temperature versus water, you have to just change the order. Right, now you can see here, you can see if water is here and temperature is here and water is here. Now, in case if you try to change here these options, like as here L, you can see here this is here L, means lines, and if you want to change it here to O, now you can see here this this line and this points, they are over plotting here, and if you want to use it here both, so you can see here now they are separated. Similarly, if you try to use it here S, you can see here this is staircase. If you try to use here H, that is histogram or high density lines. So these things are possible without any problem, you can see. And it depends on the need, that which one do you want to use it. Right, so now let me try to come back to my slides and then try to. Right, okay, so after these things, you can now I will just try to show you that that there are different types of graphics which are always possible. Right, suppose if you want to make here a smooth line also, that how the trend will go like, then we have a command here, scatter smooth, and that is included in the base package. So you simply have to say here scatter dot smooth and temp comma water, you will see the entire figure remains the same, and only this line here is added. So that will give you an idea about the trend actually. And similarly, if you you see there is a method in the statistics to create this line, so you can also change those methods here, like as here family is symmetric or Gaussian, and you can use here means xlab, ylab, ylim, xlim. Everything is possible, just like you can use it in any good graphic. All these options are possible, right? So for example, if I want to change here a different line, then I can see here L pars equal to list color equal to here red. So you can see here now this color line of the color is becoming here red, and then I'm trying to say here LWT and LWD is it, and LTY, these are the width and the length of this broken line. For example, if I want to, for example, these lines are here like this. Suppose I want to make it bigger lines, or if I want to make it here more thicker lines, means thicker marks, then this LTY and LWD are going to help me. The question comes here once, that how to decide what value of this LWT, LTY, etc. I have to use. So my very simple suggestion is that whenever you are trying to create such graph, try to choose different values of this thing and then try to see where you feel happy and where you feel satisfied. As simple as that. Right. And similarly, if you
One question. if I want to fit a smooth straight line to the data.
Straight line is a different thing actually. That is that comes under the linear regression actually. That thing is possible, but I'm sure that one speaker is possibly going to talk about the linear regression modeling. So then with that linear regression model can exactly be plotted on this line. But yes, that will be a straight line.
We will have it on fourth day, sir.
Okay.
But what you are asking, this is definitely possible.
So I want that straight line should be there and the equation should be also printed in the graph.
Yes. So for that, you have to wait till you learn the topic of linear regression modeling.
Okay, thank you, sir.
But if you wish, I remember if I can recall in one of my course in descriptive statistics with R software, I have given this option, these details. So that video is uploaded on the NPTEL site there, you can find it out. Right. Okay. And similarly, when you are trying to deal with more than two variables at a time, then you want to see how the relationship between the two. So you want to make all this pairwise plotting in the single graphic. So for that, actually, we have a command here, pairs. And pairs is the command which combines the two scattered the diagram under the same graphic. So if I say here C bind temp and water, these are two variable. So it will create here a variable like this here temp, and on the x axis this is water. So you can see here. It will be here temp and here water, and here this will be here temp and here water. Right, so now you can see here that here it is trying to give here a graphic between temperature and temperatures which doesn't make any actually sense. And similarly here it is trying to give you a graphic between water and here water, which doesn't make any sense, so this will remain as such. But here if you try to see, these are the two graphics where this is here temperature and here water, and similarly here this is here water on the y-axis and temperature on the x-axis. So you can imagine that once you have more than two to three variables, that will going to be a 3x3 or 4x4 matrix type of plot. So this is actually called as matrix plot. So by looking at all the plots at the same time, you can have a wonderful idea about the behavior of the variable. For example, when we are talking about the linear regression analysis, then we try to do such analysis. Right, but this is a way in which you can combine these graphs in different ways. Right, and then if you try to see here I'm trying to add some more options over here, like as here labels. You can see here I've written daily water demand, day temperature. So now they are written over there, as somebody was asking in the earlier question that how I can write inside the figure. Right, so in the pie diagram also, we also use this type of command here, labels, and we can change whatever we want. Right, so first, let me just complete.
Sir, I also one question.
Yeah, sure.
So actually, I'm pursuing the PhD under the topic of remote sensing and GIS. Actually, I'm drought assessment with the help of remote sensing and GIS. So for that, I downloaded the 20 years data of data set of rainfall. That is every daily rainfall data. And now I want to represent, I calculate the SPI. But how to represent that SPI in which particular graph I have to use, or if which will represent better, that I want to know.
What is SPI? I don't know.
SPI is a standard precipitation index.
I don't know what is that, because my this civil engineering or remote sensing is nearly zero.
Okay. So I have so. So that graph, I actually with the help of that plot command, I draw that graph also. But some that information that it will be presented, some particular lines will be red color, some will be blue color, some will be upward and some will be downward. So what it means that I didn't get. So can I mail you that particular file? So if you are having any kind of small amount of time, so you will guide it for me that.
You see, means you know, there are two types of people. One is doctor and say one is compounder.
Yes, sir.
So I don't do anything. Means if you just send me the file, once I don't know the precipitation index, etc. It will be very difficult for me to comment whether the graphic what you have used is right or wrong. But you are saying actually means I'm sure that you have done something which you are unable to accept. But I would suggest you that if you try to go in the reverse way, first you try to understand what the graph is trying to interpret, and then you try to use the data, then it will make sense.
Actually, sir, with the help of plot command, I draw that. But what exactly the meaning of that graph, I didn't get.
So, in fact, yes. What I'm trying to say first means when we are trying to make the scatter plot, we are trying to, using this plot command, we are trying to see how is the relationship between the two variables which are measured on x-axis and y-axis. If the line is like this, that means as x is increasing, y is also increasing. If there is a trend like this, that means as x is increasing, y is also decreasing. Similarly, I can also show you here some other plots also. So now this is actually only you who has to decide that what type of graphic is more suitable for you, right? And then when you are saying that it is blue and red, I cannot believe it, because you have done something which is very different, because plot command will give you only the dots. That's all. There will be no blue color, no red color.
Okay, sir, if you allow me, so I will share and I want to show that particular graphs if you're having
I can surely help you. But have to understand my condition that I will finish your talk at 4:30. Then from 4:45, I have a departmental meeting. And then, and then after that, I have to prepare the talks for the tomorrow's 6-hour classes. Yesterday, I slept at 2:30 a.m.
Sir, I have a suggestion, Satish, sir. A screenshot in the chat box. Maybe any one of us, because we are 200 plus teachers here in this group. Anyone of us can only help you out. You put the screenshot in the chat box.
Yes, ma'am.
But
honestly speaking, in my control, there is no chat box actually.
Yes, sir. I will WhatsApp you. That is why I'm asking. And moreover, sir, if you have studied any research papers on this topic, then you can directly mail to that author. They will definitely help you.
Something like this. You send me a CG report and ask me that whether the person is going to have a heart attack or not. That will be a very risky.
No, sir, it's really effective. If there is some doubt, then myself, I also mail to the author itself, and I always get positive responses.
Actually, that truth is this, I can share with you. When I was writing my book on designs of experiment, believe me, as a student, I never understood this topic. But at that time, I just thought that before going to my classroom, I just studied the book which was written by R.A. Fisher, who invented the design of experiment. And believe me, that was so simply written book that any layman can understand it very easily. So the best thing I'm telling you that you have to ask the corresponding author that why they have chosen that particular graph actually.
Yes.
People are trying to just simply copy and paste the same graph and then they are trying to do the same thing. But many times this creates an accident. So otherwise, means whatever means I can do in my best capacity that I will try to do. Right. So, okay, let me try to here come on, means another plot, which is here, a smooth scatter diagram. Right, so this is also a very simple plot, but you have to be careful here that here there is a capital S, and come on, here is very simple, smooth scatter, and here X. And then you have to give here the data. Actually, that can be plotted for one dimensional as well as two dimensional. So when there is one dimensional, you put here y equal to null. And when you are trying to do for two dimensional, you have to put here x and y. And you can see here there are different options which you can use to make the graphic more illustrative. For example, I have given here the list here that how you can use. Pardon?
आप कौन सी मीटिंग में बैठी हैं ये बताइए और कोई लोग दिख रहे हैं आपको उस मीटिंग में
तुम्हारा भाई कौन है हेलो
हेलो सर कैन आई इंटरप्ट एट दिस पॉइंट सर एज यू सेड अबाउट दिस स्मूथ स्कैटर एज यू जस्ट नाउ सेड अबाउट स्मूथ स्कैटर प्लॉट
I think your volume is very, very low. I cannot listen.
Is it all right now, sir?
Yeah, better.
But is it better now, sir?
Got lower.
It's still lower.
Yeah.
Sir, any improvement yes. now?
Yes.
I was just trying to say that in smooth scatter, you said you can plot one-dimensional and two-dimensional plots. Mm. And in a case, if I want to plot one-dimensional, I should say that y argument is equal to null.
Yes.
I think just in connection with the previous conversation by Satish sir, I think he has a database that he has downloaded. And probably what you are highlighting may be the reason because if you don't understand the database, it will arbitrarily pick the first column and the second column. It may plot two-dimensional or three-dimensional. So he has to also understand the database also, what exactly is getting plotted over there. And I think as you have explained in the smooth scatter command, there are so many things which are by default generated. So I understand this nbin is equal to 128 bandwidth are by default. Am I right to understand that?
That is between you and Dr. Satish. I don't know anything.
No, sir. In the slide that you are showing on the screen now.
It is possible. Surely what you are saying, that is correct. That possibly he has used some command which is creating the trouble. Yes, otherwise, simple plot command will simply give only black and white points only. There will be no blue color. There will be no red color actually.
No, like for example, the command that is seen on the screen right now, the smooth scatter x equals x comma y equal to null. The rest of the commands are by default or they are customized commands?
No, they are customized command. The default command here will be only smooth scatter x only. That is compulsion and all other are actually optional. I mean, if you have if you want to write here, say smooth scatter x y, then you have to write here y is equal to null. Otherwise, you don't write. Otherwise, you give the values over there. And all other options, they are only option. That means they are only optional. And the values which are taken, which are written here, they are the default values.
Okay, sir. Yeah, that's what I think. Thank you, sir.
So here I have given all these details about these different options so you can have a look over there. But now let me try to show you that what really happens in one way and two way. Suppose I simply try to take here only 10 observation, and that will give you a very good idea that how the things are working actually. If I take here only one variable, like as weight of 10 bags, and if I try to make it here scatter smooth, say here weight, you can see this is saying something. I don't know what it is trying to say, because this is here bag number one, bag number two, bag number three, bag number four, and so on. Right, but on the other hand, if you try to, if you try to make it here, say here, this one is smooth scatter with the is a capital S. This will try to give you here some sort of here you can see here variation. So do you know under what type of condition this smooth scatter and the scatter plot what you plotted earlier will be helpful? Whenever you have some doubts on the values, for example, if I say the room temperature. The room temperature near the air conditioner is cooler, and as you move away, that will become more more varied. If somebody says, okay, my age is 45 years, that can be 43 years, that can be 46 years. So that can be any value between 43 to 47 years or so. In that case, this scattered smooth plot is a better option, because all these values which you are seeing here, they are pointed as a in a circle, and the shade of the circle is fading. So as you are moving away from the center, that is increasing in, and that is indicating the dependence, that as you move away from the center, the dependence of the observation is decreasing, whereas this is not possible in the scattered smooth plot here like this, right? So this is possible when you don't have the exact data, then a smooth scatter plot may give you some more information. For example, if I try to take here the data on the height here, and suppose here the height, we have 50 observation here, and we try to make here the smooth scatter plot, this will look like this, some hazy picture. But it will definitely give you a much better idea when you have a two-dimensional plot, right? For example, I can show you here, yeah. Let us try to take here this one example, that where I have 20 students and their marks are recorded after a miss out of 500 versus the number of hours they have studied. So for example, if a student has studied 23 hours, he has got 337 marks. If a student has studied 25 hours, he has got 316 marks. So here, yeah, you can have a plot command also, but now I will try to show you here the smooth scatter plot. So you can see here, this is now indicating, because once you are trying to plot the line, there is always some standard error by which the line can also deviate. So it is trying to show you, okay, that this is the reason in which you can have the straight line somewhere, because every data point can also have the variability. So this will also give you some idea about the hidden tendency of the data. That much I can tell you here, right? So first, let me try to plot here these things on the R console, and then I will try to come back on these things. So anyway, so first let me try to make it here this matrix scatter plot. We already have the data on temperature and water, so I can come on the R console here. Right, you can see here, if I try to do it here, it is here like this. Right, similarly, if I try to take here the smooth scatter plot here, so I can just have here the data on the weight. I can clear the screen. This is here weight. And now if you try to create here, the scatter is smooth on this one, this is going to look like this one, but if you try to create here the means a different smooth scatter diagram, this will possibly look like here, like this thing, right? And similarly, if you try to take here this two dimension one, that will make here more sense actually, that if I try to take here the marks and hours of the student. So if I try to copy and paste the data here, so this is the marks, hours, and then smooth scatter plot. You can see here, this is here like this. So now there are different ways. You just try to get the correct information which is hidden inside the data using these graphics, and that will actually help you out actually more. That much I can say here. Right, so and then after that, do I have anything more? Yes, no, nothing. So okay, let me try to come back to my slides. I think I will just take up this topic and then I will stop, because then you can practice this also in your leisure time. Okay, now I am coming to this here another plot, which is here quantile plot. You know, when you are trying to compare two distribution or two data set, you can compare their corresponding quantiles. Now you know what is a quantile. So if I have a data set one, data set two, I try to compute the first quantile of data set one, first quantile of data set two, and I plot it here. Then I try to take the paired observations of the say the quantiles of first data set and quantiles of the second data sets, and then I try to make them proper. So obviously, if the two data set, they are exactly the same, and if you try to plot their quantiles, means every quantile is going to be the same, and then you are going to get a 45 degree line. But any deviation from there, that will indicate different types of deficiencies in your data set, right? So the command for having a quantile-quantile plot, which is popularly known as QQ plot, it is simply here QQ plot between the two data set, which are indicated by here X and Y. And there is another quantile plot, which is actually here QQ norm. In this case, what happens that X is your data and Y is the corresponding data which is generated from the normal distribution. So it tries to compare the quantiles of the of your data set and the normal distribution. Now, what will be the advantage of this? In statistics, whenever you write let X1, X2, Xn be a random sample which is coming from a normal population, then this result holds true. For example, tomorrow when we do the test of hypothesis, then every result is dependent on the basic assumption that let X1, X2, Xn be a random sample. That means the sample is coming from a normal population. And if this assumption is violated, everything after it will be affected. So the first test, first graphical test, which anybody has to do in statistics, he has to, he or she has to test whether the data is coming from a suitable distribution or not, and most popularly that is a normal distribution, right? So if you got a data, then by using the command QQ norm, you can check whether data is really coming from the normal distribution or not. And obviously, if your plot of the data is something like a straight line, then you should be happy that everything is fine. Both the distributions of the data from where you are getting X, from where you are getting Y, they are the same, or the data is coming from a normal distribution, and any deviation from here, that will indicate the deficiency in the data set, which is going to affect your means further statistical tool. And if you try to use here QQ line, this will add this type of line, which one of the participants were just asking that in the plot you want to add a line here. So in normal probability plot or in the QQ plot, you always want to compare the deviation from the straight line. So this straight line will be created by this QQ line, right? So first, let us try to understand that how to interpret these graphics. And after that, I will try to show you how to use them in the R software, or how to create them in the R software. You see,
sir,
if you try to...
Sir, it's almost 4:30.
Yeah, I will just finish. I have 4:45. I will just take a 5 minutes break. Right. Because at this moment, Miss, I need to tell it today, because when they come tomorrow, at least they know that how to test this normality. Right. So anyway, so this is if you try to plot here the data on here, say X and Y, then if all the points are lying on this line, then you can be happy that the two samples which are coming from the population X and Y, they have the similar distribution. So this is a 45 degree line actually. And in case if you are getting data like this, where the line is here like this, and data is lying mostly on the lower part of the line, then it indicates that Y value have a tendency to be lower than the X values. Remember, I'm not comparing the individual values. I'm trying to compare their population distributions, right? And similarly, if the opposite happens here, then I can interpret it, okay, in general, that X values have a tendency to be lower than the Y values. That's my interpretation. And if there are points which are concentrated on the lower side than on the upper side, means on the left hand side, means the lower and upper side of the line, then it indicates that there is a point up to which the quartiles of Y's are lower, and after that the quartiles of X becomes higher, right? So these are the different thing. And if you simply try to compare it with the normal distribution, that will give you the idea about the normality also. So if I try to take here the same data set on the heights, which has got the 50 observation, and if you try to create here a normal probability plot just by, because I have here only here one sample. So I am trying to use here the QQ norm. Otherwise, if I have two samples, means I can also create this QQ plots. So now you can see here, but the interpretation are going to be the similar. So on what is happening here, this QQ norm is something like QQ plot, in which first X is my data height, and then here I have here Y, which is from the normal data. This data is generated automatically. So now if you try to see, this is showing this type of curve. Ideally, this has to be now 100% straight line, but you can see here, well, in reality, it is very difficult to get such a 100% real line, but it is approximately linear, I can say. So, I can safely assume that my data is nearly following the normal distribution. Right, but any deviation from the line, that will indicate our final outcome. If the deviation are smaller, then the effect will not be much, but if the deviations are more, then they are going to be higher. So this is how we try to take care. And if I try to make here a line here, QQ line height, so you can see here now I get a better picture here, that I have to compare with this line. And now you can see here that most of the these points are lying exactly near to the line. So means once again, that will give us an assurance that I can safely assume here a normal distribution. Right, and similarly, And then similarly, if I try to take here this example of the same example of the marks and number of hours of study, you can see here, this curve is here like this QQ plot. So that is indicating that, okay, X and Y, they have got a similar distribution because they are straight, they are nearly lying on the 45 degrees of line here, right? And similarly, it is possible to make here the three dimension plots also. But before that, let me try to give you here this idea of this QQ plot so that you can understand it very easily. Okay, yeah, I can take here the data on its height, and I'll try to come back on the R. Console here, yes. Like this, and I can say here QQ norm. See here the height. So these things are added in the base package itself. Right, and then if you want to add here a line, so you can see here QQ line, you can see here that now this line is added on the same graphic. So that is in your hand how you want to do it. And similarly, if I want to make it here QQ plot between marks and hours, you can see here it is not difficult at all. Now it is here like this. Right, so you can see here, it is not a very difficult job. And now I will just, in the next couple of minutes, I will try to give you a quick idea about three-dimensional. Well, I will not do it here, but you can do it very easily here. So that this graphic part will be finished today. Right, you could see, creating three-dimensional plot is not difficult in our software. And there are many ways in which you can create such graphics over here. So you can see here, for that, actually, I need to have here a package scatter plot 3D that you have to install. And then you can, for example, I have created here a data, artificial data on height, weight, and here age. So I have taken it intentionally height at 100, 120, 150, and then weight here like as of the five people, ages 5, 8, 15, 18, 25. And then if I want to create here a scatter plot, this data 3D, I can write here a command that scatter plot data 3D, which is here like this. So it is giving me a first point here, second point here, third point here, fourth point here, fifth point here with the three axes, height, weight, and here age. And I have here one beautiful option that if I try to choose here an option here, angle, this picture is going to be rotated. Now I give you here a job. Try to create this data and now this put this angle inside a loop that will be changing from 0 to 360 degree. And if you try to execute that program, don't you think that this cube is going to simply rotate like this? And then you can really see what is really happening in the three-dimensional point about these points. These points can be rotated in this way, that way, that way. So this is how you can create different types of graphics in the three dimension also, right? And similarly, you can create a contour plot, dot chart. There are many, many things which you can create here. For example, I can show you here that there is an example of here perspective plot, right? Means I will say simply here, you simply try to just copy all these commands on your x-axis and use this command. I'm not giving you here the detail. You will get here this type of curve. And if you try to make here some more options over here, you will get here this type of curve. So what else do you want, man? You can create such multiple bar diagrams. You can create this multiple box plots, group blocks, box plots, etc., etc. All this in this R software. So it is not possible. This is only a starting point. And then after this, sky is the limit to achieve this beautiful graphics in the R software. So now at this moment, I will stop it with the graphical display. And tomorrow I will try to take up the correlation and covariance part. And then after that, I will come to the testing of hypothesis part. So if you have any questions, you can ask in the next 5 minutes only. Tell me one thing, this was the name Anuradha Raheja. Is she participating? Because I got a call on Truecaller, it was also showing Anuradha Raheja. So I thought that, okay, she's Anuradha Mishra actually, that was some other call. So do you have any questions or not? Or shall I leave?
Thank you very much, sir. We have to practice it.
Yes, definitely, definitely. I will be very honest in accepting that in this online business, whatever we have done tomorrow and today, that was actually a 3 days material.
Sir, I think more than that. Has raised her hand also.
Right, so if there are no more questions, I will take your leave and I will request you all to just to have a look on the slides, recordings, possibly another we will be having. And if you have any problem, tomorrow we will see at 9:30 and then you can ask me anything, whatever we have done today. Right, so thank you very much. Now I will switch over to my next meeting from 4:45. Take care, bye-bye.
Thank you so much, sir.